PowerWash Simulator is one of those games that's just so silly from the outside, but as soon as you start playing, it's really clear how they've made tens of millions of dollars. It's just so satisfying. Then you have games like Splatoon that let you make a mess of the world, or Mario Sunshine, which lets you do both, and the cool thing is, these are pretty much the exact same effect. So how do we create it? Well, with the eighth wonder of the world and the answer to all of life's problems, shaders, of course. But first, we're going to need an environment to power wash. I really enjoyed the skate park level in Power Wash Simulator, so I found this awesome skate park made available under Creative Commons 4.0 by FlunkedPunk on Sketchfab, and grabbed that. Thanks, FlunkedPunk. With this awesome skate park brought into Unity and a little bit of basic lighting and post-processing, because I just can't seem to help myself, it's time to get to work. So in my last video, I explained how we can seamlessly map a texture onto a 3D surface using a technique called Triplanar Mapping, and we'll use the same technique here to layer some dirt on our models. The idea is very simple. We have our basic shading where we just sample the main texture and multiply it by a color, same as you have in the default shader, but we're going to blend in our dirtiness. This is a second texture. I'm using a nice crunchy dirt texture that came with the skate park, but it could be anything. Paint, dirt, mold, you name it. Now we can use a float to control the blend, where one is filthy and zero is clean, using a lerp to transition between the two. Lerp, of course, is short for linear interpolation and ranks number one, just ahead of the dot product, on my list of most useful shader functions. The basic idea is that you provide any values a and b, and a float t, where t is between 0 and 1. If you pass 0, then we get a back, if you pass 1, they get b back, and anything between will be a linear blend between a and b. It's also worth noting that you can totally do this in ShaderGraph, which comes with a really handy triplanar node, but I prefer HLSL personally, so that's what I'll be doing. Cool. Now instead of using a simple float to control the dirtiness, let's try using a mask texture. The idea is the same, but instead of using a single float for the entire mesh, we now have one per pixel stored in a texture. We still get a value from 0 to 1 indicating the dirtiness, but we get it from the texture using the object UV. Now if I use a white texture, we're fully dirty, if I use a black texture, we're fully clean, and a noisy texture in between will modulate the dirtiness per pixel. To start, we'll use this tiny white texture as the default on all materials. This will give us the best performance for objects that haven't been interacted with yet, and then all we need to do is generate this mask dynamically based on the player's power washer as they start spraying the environment. Alright, I started with a painter class, which has a color, a radius, and a range. Each frame, while the fire button is held down, I run a Spherecast forward and see if I find a paintable surface, a class I'll write in a minute, passing in the painter and the Raycast hit to its paint function. I've attached the script to the main camera, so we're always power washing from the center of the frame, but you'd ideally put this on your power washer or your ketchup bottle or ink gun or whatever you're cleaning or making a mess with. So, inside the paintable surface class, the first time the player paints or cleans the surface, we need to generate a new render texture to represent our dirtiness. I've initialized this new render texture as white as well, so at this point the object is still 100% dirty, and I pass it into our main material as the dirt mask, replacing the static white default texture we've been using up until now. I also set up a command buffer. This is essentially a repeatable list of draw commands that we can submit to the GPU, which really just paints our mesh and all of its submeshes onto our render texture, using a new shader that we'll write in a moment. I'm also double buffering here, drawing the render texture over top of itself, which lets us paint continuously, rather than losing the previously painted state every time we draw. Cool. So finally, back in the paint function, we can pass the raycast position and the normal vector, along with the paint color and radius, into the paint shader that we're about to write, before executing our command buffer. This paintable surface class has a ton of code to manage materials, static batching, all of that stuff, which I'm not going to go over here because it's dreadfully boring, but it's in the repo that I'll link below if you want to reference what I've done there. Cool, onto the shader. Oh, actually, you know what? Hold up a second. So we have a bit of a problem. Our dirtiness mask is a 2D texture, but we have a 3D model that we're trying to paint. We know the position and the normal vector of the point where we're painting from our raycast, but where on the texture do we actually put the paint? Well, we can convert the world space paint position to the object's UV space, but there are two big problems with relying on the main UV map. So oftentimes you'll have overlapping UVs, where sections of the mesh want to share the same part of a texture. This is a really handy technique for things like texture atlases, but in this case, we'd end up painting multiple distinct parts of the mesh, which we really don't want. The second issue is that oftentimes UVs will exceed the range of 0 to 1. This is usually for repeating textures, and again, we'd end up painting multiple parts of the object in this case. What we really need is a UV map that's constrained to the range of 0 to 1 and without ever overlapping, so every pixel is guaranteed to represent a unique part of the mesh. That's going to be a very frustrating constraint to have on all of our meshes though, so we need a second UV map. Luckily, Unity has a handy checkbox to generate this exact UV map for light baking, storing it in the second UV slot on our mesh, and guaranteeing that there's no overlap, and all UVs fit within the bounds of 0 to 1. Thanks Unity, super cool. Let's all just remember to update our dirt mask sampling in the main shader to use the new light map UV, and not waste an hour wondering why this isn't working later on. All right, let's write our paint shader to render our dirtiness mask. So the goal of the vertex shader here is to simply flatten our mesh into UV space using that light map UV generated by Unity. This maps the mesh into UV space and fits it onto our dirtiness texture. Then in the fragment shader, we can simply check the world position of our pixel and whether it's in range of the paintbrush and use that to dictate the alpha value. And this works. We can hold our mouse down and power wash surfaces. Super neat. Honestly, even without all the effects and particles and scores, it already feels pretty good. But there are two really obvious issues that I'm seeing. The first is that I can't really get into the inner corners between surfaces. The painting just sort of stops. The second is that on the outer corner of a surface, we're able to kind of clean around the corner when it should really only clean the visible face. For the first problem, the issue is that I'm running a Spherecast and only painting the first surface it collides with. Instead, I tried collecting all of the surfaces that the Spherecast hits and painting all of them. But this introduced a new problem of being able to paint through surfaces because the Spherecast no longer stops at the first surface it hits. So instead what I landed on is to first do a basic raycast at the max range of the painter. And if we get a hit, then do a sphere overlap test to find all colliders in range of that point. Cool, now we're able to get into the corners between surfaces, painting both at the same time, and we can't shoot our paintbrush through surfaces. Sorry, I just had to clean that. Right, anyways, we had a second problem. So, we can quickly fix the outer corner wrapping issue in the paint shader by adding a second test in the fragment stage. This is going to compare the normal direction of the surface with the normal of the paintbrush, ensuring that we're only painting surfaces that are actually looking at the paintbrush. Now we can't wrap our paint around corners, but we also can't paint outer corners, which isn't great. So it turns out the normal vector that we get from a sphere overlap test doesn't work the way I thought. So quick fix, let's just use the inverse of the raycast direction as the normal. Sweet, now we can paint around corners, we get into all the nooks and crannies, and it all behaves exactly as you'd expect. Now we have a very basic power wash simulator effect, and we can invert it too, making the environment dirtier by changing the paint color based on which button the player is pressing. Now we can clean and dirty the environment, and if you swap out the dirt texture, you can really make this anything. Paint, dirt, ketchup, you name it. Or you could get rid of the texture entirely and just use the color from the mask to paint in all different colors. But in order to really make this a game like Power Wash Simulator, there's one major feature that's missing, and surprisingly, in my opinion, it's actually the most complicated part by far. See, to make Power Wash Simulator, you need to be able to show the player how clean a surface is. Now, the naive approach would be to load our dirtiness texture back onto the CPU and to iterate through every pixel to add up a dirtiness score. But copying all this data back is extremely inefficient and it would absolutely destroy our frame rate, so we really need to solve this on the GPU. A shader running on the GPU already has access to the data, but GPUs are meant for parallelized operations. They're extremely bad at this kind of sequential data access. We'd absolutely bottleneck our GPU running a loop over the entire texture. One way you could solve this would be with mipmaps, just copying back the smallest texture to use as an approximation. This might very well work, but there is a way to get an accurate number. Since this little project is really just a technical challenge and meant for fun, I'm going to go with the kind of quote-unquote real solution, which is an algorithm called parallel reduction, and specifically the sequential addressing variant. I've written a compute shader that can reduce an image into a smaller buffer of sums. Each thread group is responsible for summing a subset of pixels equal to the thread group size. So if we have a thread group size of 256, then we get a sum of 256 pixels and store that result in a buffer. This allows us to divide the work of summing pixels up into worker groups, who all go off and sum up their portion of the image and report back. We then do this over and over and over, on smaller and smaller buffers, until we're finally left with a single float containing the entire sum of the whole image. The trick is to then balance the threading parameters so each thread isn't doing too much work, but we also don't need to iterate too many times. This is kind of confusing, so let's walk through an example just to make sure it's clear. Let's say our dirtiness texture is 2048 by 2048, or roughly 4.19 million pixels. Assuming we dispatch with 256 threads, then we reduce our 4.19 million pixels down to 16,384 partial sums, each representing the sum of 256 pixels. On our next pass, our 16,384 partial sums get reduced to 64 partial sums. Then in our final pass, we reduce the 64 partials into one final sum, representing the sum of all 4.19 million pixels. We can then copy back that single float to the CPU, which is much more efficient than copying the entire texture. There's a great paper by NVIDIA showing a bunch of variations on this algorithm and how to optimize this further, which I'll link down below. Finally, we can divide this sum by the total number of pixels in the original texture to get our dirtiness and act as our score. Now we can display a cleanliness checklist for all of our paintable surfaces by measuring the dirtiness each time an object is painted, and we finally have a bit of a gain here. It's super cool. And of course it works both ways. If we dirty up a surface, then the score is reduced. You could totally make a Splatoon meets PowerWash Simulator kind of party game with this, but unfortunately, as always, it's not so easy. Even though I fully cleaned this ramp, I can't quite get the score all the way to 100%, so what gives? Let's look at our dirtiness mask and see what's gone wrong. Ah, now that we look at it like this, it's really clear to see that the lightmap UV generated by Unity is pretty inefficient. There's a lot of wasted space. It would be much more efficient to pack the texture ourselves in Blender, but you're never going to use 100% of the texture space, so we're always going to have to account for this empty space. We're calculating the score for the entire image when we should really only consider pixels that fall within a valid UV island. Otherwise, we'll never paint them and therefore never achieve 100% cleanliness. So back in the paint shader, I've added a keyword to simply render the input color for all pixels, which we can then use when we initialize the mask. Rather than initializing the entire texture as white as we've been doing up until now, we can now initialize it fully transparent, and then only the used portions of the texture can be flooded with white. Now we end up with this nice mask, which perfectly represents the portions of the texture that are actually used, and in our parallel reduction, we can simply skip any pixels with a zero in the alpha channel. Sweet! We can get pretty close to 100% now, though I think we might need a little bit of fuzziness to grant the player some leeway, and account for some possible floating point precision issues. But, did you see that? Now the first time we clean a surface, the cleanliness score jumps up a massive percentage, which is obviously incorrect. Ah, of course. This is because our dirtiness is calculated by taking the sum of our parallel reduction, which is the total dirtiness of all of our masked out UV pixels, divided by the size of the entire image. This is effectively treating the non-UV pixels as being cleaned, which we don't want. They need to be ignored. Instead of dividing by the total number of pixels, we need to divide by the total number of pixels within a valid UV. This is going to require another parallel reduction to sum up the valid pixels. However, we can do it in the same pass for performance. I've simply switched all the floats to float 2s, where the second float is either a 0 or 1 to indicate if it's a valid pixel. The float 2s get summed up exactly the same, and in the end we read back 2 floats onto the CPU instead of 1. The first is the sum dirtiness, and the second is the sum of valid pixels. And there we have it. Of course, now that we have the space implementation in place, you can really see how far we are from making this as satisfying as a Splatoon or a PowerWash Simulator. A major improvement would be to replace the simple radius check with a texture representing our brush in the paint shader. This would add some noise and texture to the effect. Manipulating the normal of the painted surface would also give the dirt or paint some depth. Right now it looks really flat, which is fine for this low poly environment, but wouldn't really feel great in a more realistic setting. As a bit of a hint, the DDX and DDY HLSL functions are a very efficient way to achieve that. For gameplay, you could also define different nozzles, so the player can choose between strength, size, or shape, but I'll leave these improvements as an exercise for you to explore. I love recreating these effects, it's a lot of fun, but this is only a starting point. To get something as satisfying as a polished game like PowerWash Simulator takes a lot more time than I could possibly afford to spend on each video, unfortunately. But this gets us far enough along to understand how these effects can actually be achieved. Thank you so much to all of my patrons, and an extra special thank you to my magpies and my ospreys, Elegon, Purple Sloth Studio, Jason Hansen, Ellie Swale, Raven Painted, Justice Lind, Brandon Pung, Peter James, Eric Perdunsky, Math Merkel, Chupaca, Carson Strout, and TNT Games TV. Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got a skate park to clean.